Talking about the things that make your home service business go. Marketing, finance, systems, people. This is the Fight Club for Business podcast.
Why, howdy. Good morning. Well, hello. And welcome to the Fight Club, everyone. Hi.
Welcome to Fight Club. Tay is still stuck in a storm or something. She's going to join us in a little bit. So can I be Tay this week for a second?
You can.
Guys?
Please be Tay. Be Tay for a moment. Yes.
Welcome to Fight Club. Tay has the best job. Yay. She's the one that gets to do the welcome. So welcome. We are a team of industry experts who help you fight for your business in the four areas of business that we notice a lot of businesses struggle. So we cover finance and marketing and people and systems. And every week we like to bring on a new guest that can share their experience and their expertise with us. And I'm so excited to have my dear friend Curt Kempton with us today. We're going to go ahead and introduce ourselves. And so, Curt, I'm going to let you introduce yourself in just a second here. And so my name is Megan Likes. I'm the founder of Bookkeeping Academy Online. I educate and empower small business owners to know their numbers so they can live more financially rewarding lives. I also am the owner of Likes Accounting Company, where if you don't want to do the bookkeeping or the accounting or you're allergic to math, you can outsource those services to my office and team. And I own a window cleaning and gutter cleaning company. So I am really happy to be here on this Tuesday morning. Welcome to Fight Club. Curt Kempton, tell us who you are, what you're about, and why you're here. I don't think he knows why he's here, but we're really happy.
Yeah, I was gonna say, the reason I'm here is because I love all these ladies and they invited me into this Russian roulette of a meeting, but I feel like it's going to be safe. I'm Curt Kempton. I'm the founder of ResponsiBid, creator of the sales system that we know is ResponsiBid today. My job is to help business owners to close more jobs at higher average ticket prices with less effort. And I have devoted my whole life to building sales systems that don't suck.
I love it. Welcome, Curt. I'm Michelle Myers, co-owner of Pink Collars. I tried to get Doug to stay to do a Fight Club, like video bomb, but he had to run today. And my husband and I run Pink Collars. We put remote CSRs or customer service rock stars in your home service business and help you close sales and follow up with customers and do all of that hand-holding and customer service that you may need in addition to ResponsiBid. And I'm so excited you're here. Welcome, Curt.
And I'm Martha Woodward. I am founder of Quality Driven Software, co-founder. And I have an online course and membership all about people and management. And so welcome to Fight Club. And yes, Megan, he's not just your guest. He's all of our guests.
You're right. That's right. And you noticed his haircut. So, I mean, we all know where we rank. And we don't have Bobby Walker here. So, like, yeah, Curt, out of the three of us, which one are you close? No, just kidding. We're not going to do the Bobby Walker.
Do that. Well, only one of you has been to my house. So,
That's correct.
That's correct.
Yeah. Wow. The other two of you and Taylor need to get on it. Get the
I'm
but
going.
I haven't been to your new house yet.
That's so true.
I have to come to your new house and beat these other two.
I do wave every time I'm in the Phoenix airport.
That's true. Megan has sent me so many texts. I'm waving from Sky Harbor. And I'm like, that is so far away from me. It's a 45-minute drive, but if I got more heads up, I could like be at the gate waiting.
And now she's boxer you.
Yeah, that's right.
That is kind of Martha's fault, actually, Curt. You have Martha to thank for this. So
I don't get to take credit for that.
It all worked out. Okay, well, I was hoping Tay would be here because usually she's the one that starts and we have this whole order. We're very OCD about this, but we're gonna have to go out of order this week. So we're gonna start with finances. And funny story, I was trying to think yesterday, what did I want to bug you about? Because there are so many things that I wanted to bug you about, like how you doubled the profits of my business in the first year of using ResponsiBid. And this is not a commercial for ResponsiBid, but like, I like money and your software makes me a lot of money. So I thought we could talk about that. And then I was thinking like, or how I booked almost six figures from the first week of using ResponsiBid, because you have such good email automations and follow-up sequences and all these really cool things that make my office manager job way easier. And then I was thinking we could just talk about Bobby Walker, because, you know, like, that's a favorite subject. And then I was thinking, like, I kind of want to bug you about your 5-star window cleaning top secret training program, but then that's stepping on Martha's toes, and I know it's kind of top secret, so I'm going to stay away from that one. I have two choices, and I'm going to let you choose. I never let the guests choose. One, we could talk about Level Up, because I think it's amazing that you built a profitable business that now gives back. And you give back to people that you serve, and you give back with your user base, which I'm all about giving back. And I think that's pretty amazing. So we could talk about that.
That would be a really fun one to talk about.
Okay. The other thing we could talk about, though, is sales. Because here's the thing. We cover systems, people, marketing, and finance, but we don't talk about sales very much. Sales are kind of the root of having a strong, financial, healthy company. Because if you have all your percentages in line, you know, sales is where we start, and then everything dials in down below that. And you run a sales conference for the service industry, the only sales conference for the entire service industry. So I was like, I feel like
I have an idea. Take Tay's place and do sales.
Yep.
And then you can be you and do
Level Up. Okay.
I love it. Yep. With it.
All right. So perfect. I don't want to lead you, because you are an excellent speaker and you know exactly what you're talking about, but you have given a couple of talks in our friendship that have changed my life. So I am going to lead you with that very, like, you know, big shoe to fill, that you talk a lot about sales behavior and why your software is different than any other software out there, because you really do pay attention to behavior. So that is my leading question. And you have a few minutes to banter with us about that leading question.
Sure. So basically, my whole approach to sales is that there are two, in my experience, there's two types of service business owners. There's the one who really embrace sales and they want to be very hands-on and get in there and really coax every sale through and hire salespeople and stuff, because they don't have any weird stigma or hesitations about sales. And then there's a lot of other people who've had, usually the common thread is they've had a really negative sales experience where someone sold them something they didn't need or want. They felt like they were worked over and they felt dirty after working with a salesperson. So then once they have to give themselves the title of salesperson, the reason I started ResponsiBid is because I was one of these people, is that it doesn't fit their DNA. A lot of people, and in the service industry, I think that's every time I do it, by raise of hands, it's like 98% of the people raise their hand and go, that's me. That's, I feel dirty when I do sales. Yeah. So
the thing is that
it's a shame, because if done correctly, sales is actually one of the greatest opportunities you have as a business owner. It's where you get to extend yourself personally into so many people's lives and be able to maximize. And of course, the reason we have a business is to be profitable, which I'd love to talk more about numbers about that in a minute. But what I've done is I've tried to distill down in those two categories what their experience is. A salesperson done properly will feel really good and wholesome. But that really bad thing, I like to call that like the snake oil salesman. It's the person who's walking around with one elixir who fixes all your problems. Just give me your money. Just give me your money. Take this elixir that's made out of sugar water, and I'm going to tell you it's snake oil and it's going to fix all this stuff for you. And whatever your problem is, this is the solution. And the solution really doesn't come down to anything other than the transaction. The snake oil salesman doesn't care what's in the bottle. They don't care what happens after the sale. They really only care about taking your money and going to the next sale. And so when someone has dealt with a snake oil salesman who's selling cars, or someone who's selling maybe multi-level marketing products, or, you know, whatever it was that was dirty, we start relating that really dirty experience, when really a good sales experience is more like a doctor. I mean, if you went to the doctor and the doctor was like really afraid of being too salesy, and you walk in, you're like, oh, doc, I've been struggling with this thing for so long and it hurts so bad. And they're like, Yeah, that, wow. Well, you know, I don't want to like charge you more for tests, and I don't really want you to have to buy any prescriptions. Maybe just get some rest. Call me in a couple of weeks if it's still hurting. If you get a doctor that was like that, you'd feel really ripped off. You want someone to come at you, help you find, ask the questions, what's the solution, and get that. And you'd actually appreciate a doctor who got you the testing that you needed, or the medication that made you feel better and got you onto the path of recovery. And the fact is that every time your phone rings, somebody has a solution that they're looking to get. And the problem is that if you come at it too soft, you're actually doing a disservice to your customer. And like Megan said, all your sales add up to 100%, no matter how big your business is. 100% of the money into your business adds up, and that's your sales. And then everything else in your business is a percentage of that. So your labor will be a percentage of that 100%. Your fuel costs will be a percentage of that 100%. Your marketing costs, your uniform costs, your safety training costs, your chemical costs, all the different costs that you have in your business are all a percentage of that 100% number. And if you don't elevate that 100% number to make it so that all of those percentages that need to be what they are, if that math doesn't work, you failed your family, you failed your employees, you failed your customer. Like, there's just so many people. And so I guess what I try to tell people is, please don't let your bad experience with a terrible snake oil salesman salesperson make you into the person who is not doing right by your business and your family and your customers.
Well, and I feel like you've taken away the snake oil salesman in your product. My husband, Jeff, we talk about him a lot on Fight Club, everybody, and Curt knows Jeff. So he was like terrified of sales. Like, he was the guy that Curt would say, he would like leave the bid and he would like hide and he would like run away and be like, call me if you want. You know, that was Jeff. And he would like, he probably wouldn't yell.
Yeah. You hand it to him and you run back to your car as fast.
And he probably would whisper, like, just call if you want to get on the schedule. He might still kind of do that, but thanks to ResponsiBid, he doesn't do that many bids anymore, because ResponsiBid does most of our bids for us. And I remember like 2 years ago, we were on vacation, and Jeff is the only person in our company who's ever done bids. And Martha will tell us everything that's wrong with that, and she's been working on it, and we're trying to fix it. But we were on vacation and we were unplugged in a national park for 2 weeks, almost 3 weeks. And we got back and ResponsiBid had done like 49 bids for us. And there wasn't any like sneaky sliding it under the door, call if you want. Like, these people were scheduling themselves. They were choosing a package that was exactly what they wanted. And it's been amazing, because now Jeff does estimates once a week. There's about 3 to 5 of them every week. And those are like the in-person ones that just have too many exceptions based on the software. And it's just become really efficient for us. And I think it's made for a better user experience, because Curt could talk about this for an hour. He actually could talk about this for like 3 hours or 8 hours, but he talks about how, like, if your customers are on the internet and they're wanting to buy your services, don't make them call you and talk to you. Don't make them.
Not if they don't want to, right?
If they don't want to,
So. Okay, that was really good. Did we hit it well enough, ladies?
Yeah.
Sales? Okay.
I mean, we've
talked about how Fight Club needs more sales discussions, but we're all works in progress here on this topic.
Maybe one thing I'll just add is that you know, I've talked to Michelle quite a bit, and one of the things about sales is that if you have just a straight up script, it's going to come off more snake oil salesperson-y. Michelle's talked about systems, and one of the things that amazed me about her is that she'll always pull out like this crazy system that's like really tuned for the specific thing it's designed for. One of the things about a system is that it allows scripts to be used, which are a very important part of every business and training new people. One of the things I admire about Pink Collars is that you could literally hire someone for your business, and then Michelle will train them and onboard them and get them running your business really, really well. But a system usually has branches in it, you know, like if the customer wants this, go this way. If the customer doesn't want that, go the other way, or whatever. Anyway, my point is that you could have 15 or 20 micro scripts or, you know, whatever in your sales process, if we're talking about just the phone portion of it or the in-person portion. And those scripts mixed up properly, given the input of customers, can turn into thousands of different types of scripts just because of the variation. And so people who are worried about not being themselves, the fact is that everybody wants to put their best foot forward. So if you'll spend the time investing in those little micro scripts and understanding how your sales system works, if you just spend a little bit of time, you'll see that not only can you get the right thing to every customer in the best possible light, but you'll also see how natural it feels. And that's why it's so amazing that you can take, you know, one little thing like window cleaning or pressure washing or, you know, maid service, it doesn't matter what your service is, but you don't have to fit into the box of every other cleaning company does similar services to you, because at the end of the day, and I'm sure this is a part Martha would hit on, is that every business is as individual as the owner's values. So anyway, yeah.
Can I brag on you for 2 seconds? Again, sorry. And actually, I just love ResponsiBid, and we use it for a window cleaning company, if you haven't picked that up. And Martha uses it. And Michelle, we had to hire pink collars, and she was able to pick up our ResponsiBid in like 24 hours and get it off and running. And it was amazing because it does make a really good system. So it's so good that I signed up for ResponsiBid recently for my accounting company. And I did that because my office manager has been wanting to transition to sales, and she's really struggled with all those paths of the tree, because she doesn't have a background in accounting and she has a little bit of confidence issues around bookkeeping. And so we got ResponsiBid because the call screen walks her through every one of those decision tree points. And I've done all the math behind the scenes in the pricing matrix so that she can have confidence in the output that comes out. It also has the disqualifier, so that can be terrifying when you're selling a product like accounting services and maybe you're not gonna be the best accountant for that client. I was able to put in those disqualifiers for her that would give her the red flag, like, oh, let's maybe stop this conversation and talk to Megan, or, oh, maybe we're not the best fit, you know, in her sales script. Here's some recommendations of people who are. So I know we're here to serve the service industry, and I love what ResponsiBid does for my business, but that's a really good point about sales scripts. And for me, it's also a huge confidence boost for a very qualified staff member who just needs like a better system to follow, a better tool to follow so that she can really excel. So thank you, Curt and ResponsiBid. You're the best.
Yay.
Pink collars.
Thank you, Tay. Thank you, Tay/Megan. Okay, Megan, you're up again.
No, let's go around and we can finish with me. Because okay. If Tay comes back, I'll let her come back. So
okay, perfect. Do you want me to go next? I'll go next.
We're all out of order, Curt. Like, we don't know what to do. There's no
Okay. So I was looking up in preparation for seeing you. I was looking up some of the stats on sales follow-ups and what it really requires to follow up with people to close sales. And there's tons of stats out there, but the general rule of thumb that I'm finding is it looks like the number 5 is pretty important. 5 touches, either 5 emails or a text and a couple of emails or a phone call and a couple of texts. And tell me how ResponsiBid helps to sequence those. And as a user, you can go in and modify those touch points, correct?
Yeah.
Tell me how that works so that people understand, because that's a huge help in this system of sales.
It's funny. I've dedicated my life to learning how the mechanisms of sales work. And it's funny that stat, when I first got in, everybody agreed it was 7. Then it went up to 30 and like 50, and now we're back down to 5. I think that the true reality of it is that there's averages and then there's your business's averages. Just remember that any average, you need to have higher numbers and then there'll be less. There'll be some people on the very first interaction that are going to go with you. And we've all experienced that. You kind of walk in, you put your solution out, and the person you're working with is, as they say in the personality disc profile, they're the D. Mm-hmm. Like, let's go. Let's go.
Yeah.
But your people who are going to study it out, they're the ones who bring the averages basically up, right? The number of touches that it takes. So I would never let anyone like get away with only having 5 touches in your sales process because the people who are only getting to take 1 touch are throwing your numbers off, and you want to capture the people who need 10. So what I would say is that in ResponsiBid, the way we designed it was that you basically build out, we call them statuses, but really maybe a better way to think of it is buckets. Every single one of your customers, no matter what part of the buying process they're in a bucket that is similar to other people. There's mm-hmm. the people who have gotten a quote, but you never heard another word back. That's, we call those open people. There's people who are pending, people who mm-hmm. got a quote, said, yeah, I think I'd like the schedule. Let's get a date. But there's never been a date chosen. So it's never actually, it like, it's warmer than open, but not.
Yeah, not really quite there yet.
Yeah. And then of course there's everything in between, and then there's declined, and declined is actually the gold. So maybe I'll just spend a moment talking to you about declined, because that's the one I feel that like full on Thanksgiving dinners get shoved off the table and it hits the floor. Like when we're not talking about crumbs, we're talking about big, gigantic turkeys that are hitting the floor. So what's happening is people are going out and giving quotes, and the person says, no, we're going to go a different way. And as the snake oil salesman scaredy cats that we are, because we don't want to be that guy, what we do is we go, okay, thanks. Thanks for your time. Goodbye.
Yep. See you later.
Run away. And there's a big problem with that. The problem is that we know when we gave that quote that we offered the right service for them. And we know that ethically we would always do the right thing for our customers. So when you run away, you run away, you let them choose the low cost provider. And maybe the low cost provider will be able to do service well for a week or a month or a year. But ladies, what do we know is kind of the common thread with the low cost provider when someone makes a decision on price?
Yeah. It ends up biting them in the backside. Yeah. Generally speaking, yeah, it just doesn't work out.
Yeah, it'll typically have its way of falling apart. And that's what I was saying mm-hmm. earlier about sales. Everything is a percentage of that nut top line. So if the low cost provider is bringing on tons and tons of customers at a low price, their 100% number may only be, you know, too small to support the marketing, to support the labor costs, to support the fuel costs, to support the insurance costs. At some point, someone who's underpriced will not be able to serve their customer anymore, because 100% will only divide so many ways. And the dollars that they translate to may not support an effective business. Certainly, probably not communication. They're not going to have the office staff. They can't afford the office staff that's necessary. Yeah. So what's going to happen is that every time someone tells you no, and they go with the low cost provider, the chances are that they made the decision based on price, and they will leave the decision based on something else. Yeah. The price was good, but the blank was bad. Yeah. The communication was bad. The service was bad. The quality was bad. Mm-hmm. The way the employees that came into my home smelled was bad. You know, it doesn't matter what it was, but at some point they say, you're leaving and I'm going to start finding a new person again. Well, if you had a decline status when someone said no to you, that said, you know, in the very first email, the first follow up I always recommend, and then, oh, Taylor's here. Taylor's here.
Hey, Speck. Hey. You want to know how I have my computer set up right now, guys. I kind of want you to take off your background so you can see where you are, but we won't make you.
Okay. Sorry, Kurt. Go ahead. Sorry, Kurt.
Anyway, in the decline status, if we start out by telling the customer, we're sure that you made a great decision. Number one, we're supporting the customer in their decision. We're not coming off as we're going and putting our arm around their shoulder and looking forward with them, saying, I'm sure whatever you've done is good. We're not taking an offensive approach. Like, well, we're sure you're probably going to be dissatisfied at some point, so call us. Like, yeah. What kind of customer would like be like, oh, cool, I'm glad they have no faith in my decision making skills.
It's so terrible.
You start off by letting them know, you know, we're sure that you made a great decision for you. Yeah. However, we are 100% committed to your satisfaction. So if there's anything we can do, please let us know. You know, because when that person comes to pressure wash their house and their zebra stripes, they don't want to feel stupid calling you back. Right?
Yeah.
So the first email is really just setting the stage for, we think you're great. And if something ever went bad at any point, we're the kind of people that won't rub it in your face. Okay. And you don't say it that way, obviously. Yeah. I don't think there's anyone listening that would think that that's how you're going to say it, but that's the undertone. The second email goes out at a proper interval when they probably have received service and maybe had bad service. So the second email or text or whatever is going to basically come out and say, you know, Hi, customer. I know that you ended up going a different route than us and had some services completed. We hope they turned out wonderfully for you. But in the meantime, we just wanted you to know we're here for you. And we think, you know, we love what we do. And if there's ever anything you, any questions you have for us so that we can answer, we'd be happy to do it. Yeah. Because when someone just had someone up on their roof that didn't kill all the moths, or that for whatever they had reason had a bad experience, they're at that point not even going to be calling you. They would be a little bit embarrassed to come back and say, can you come fix it? It would be more like, do you think that this picture that I'm sending you right now is good quality work? So you basically want to fish and see if they'll come back to you with some sort of you're the expert. Can I get a second opinion from you on if this person did a good job? Or is it normal for people to show up 3 days later than what they said they were going to show up? Well, that wouldn't be normal our company, but we do find that is pretty common in the area. It's something that we pride ourselves in not doing, you know. And now you can see how all of a sudden you're turning the tide and you're opening a conversation, because the decline status is all about not leaving the conversation. The moment you say goodbye to someone, it's all over. But if you use a decline status and you put someone in and you have like 10 touches over the next 5 years,
sure.
What happens is you're just keeping the same conversation going and you're never saying goodbye.
Yeah.
Now, they haven't ever given you any money, but at some point, the people who they're paying money to won't answer the call. And here is this person I've never given money to, and they are constantly giving me good value and not annoying me. And all of a sudden, at some point, when they're dissatisfied with the other person, they still remember your name, they remember who you are, and they remember how you made them feel, and they remember that this person does not evaporate.
So, you know, sometimes they call us.
Huge.
Sometimes they call us and they're like, yeah, you did it last time. And we're like, no, we didn't. But I mean, you email me. Well, yeah. But well, they'll call us thinking we were the provider because we're in their inbox. It's awesome. It's so fun. And we're like, well, clearly the other guys didn't email you. They left no impression. So sure. Okay. We're happy to give you a new quote.
Love it.
Okay. I want to touch briefly on integrations, because everybody wants to know, how can they plug ResponsiBid into a CRM that they use now or a system that they use now? So just highlight your top providers that you integrate with, and then I'm going to bounce you over to Martha. So please.
So it's just important people understand that ResponsiBid's not an operational CRM. It's basically the part that gets people to buy from you first and also in the future. We are not a work order system. We read your calendaring system. We can create work orders once the job is sold, but we connect really well with Jobber, with Customer Factor, Service Monster, House Call Pro. We have Zapier connections that can be useful for different things. Not to get too into the whole Ferrari update, but right now, one of the most exciting things is that it's looking like there's a lot of dominoes that have had to fall this year, and we've spent a lot of time setting up dominoes so that when we push one, it'll all connect. But we're getting ready to move into rewriting all of our connections. And so we're really excited right now about, in about 30 days from now, we can't launch it until it connects, because our software is very reliant on connections, and they're all about to get a lot stronger. So we're super excited.
Quality driven software is a completely automated process for us, because we have ResponsiBid talking to Jobber, talking to QDS, and it triggers all of our surveys for us automatically. So
actually, QDS falls in the same category, and SendGym too, where we're not like, we're all CRM-ish, but not CRMs. Mm-hmm. And we all work best when we connect like a big web. So Martha and I kind of, that's where we come together.
Love it. Perfect. Thanks, Curt. I love it. Thank you.
So, Curt, there was a conversation about ResponsiBid yesterday in a cleaning business group. And anyway, I asked the person, she was asking about ResponsiBid, wasn't happy with her current online booking system. And I said, well, what are you not happy about? And she said it was the customer service. And I said, well, I haven't had to use support very much myself, but I can vouch for it's a great team and da 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 da. And it's funny. Susan Stalker, I know she wouldn't mind me saying her name. She goes, I call them every day and their service is top notch. You know, I don't know what she has to call you about, but
I talk
people to visit to, with.
I talked to David every day for 8 weeks, I think, when we first set it up. Poor David. I think actually, put a cap on David Axis after Megan because it was so bad.
Well, I think one of the most important things about let me just real quick go through our company values, and this will answer some questions. But like Susan Stalker, she's got a very large company, and there's a lot of like added complexity with a company that size. We just love serving. But our mission in Symphasize, as a company that makes ResponsiBid, is to restore order and enthusiasm to what we call the blue collar worker. Basically, the people who most software companies are like, we'd rather work with dentist offices, you know? But what our first value is that we're a family that treats each other like royalty, and we do it through service and a little bit of weirdness. So that's sort of our internal value about how we treat each other. But the second thing is we keep it real. And that is because I used to own a service business, and I heard those corporate jargon speak people come and try to like help me. And it's just condescending and annoying, and it's unnecessary. So we always keep it real. But the one thing that our values, I think where if you contact our service, you will always feel this, is that one of our values is service is the glory. So we're not looking to be on a pedestal. The fact that we get to serve you, the fact that people allow us, when you reach out to us through chat, you know, when you call us or we get to talk to you, that's the glory right there. Just the fact that you trust us with your business. So like when you talk to David or Hunter or Haley or me or anybody else, we're just grateful that you guys, as you're building your business, your empire, that you're trusting us to be part of that empire. So anyway, there's a few other things, but giving back, inspiring passion. Those are all things that we live by here.
So I cover something around people and people management. And I have to tell the story of when Curt and I met. So Megan, I was like his stalker. And Megan always said she was my stalker. But it was a small room and I didn't know who Curt was from Adam. And then he was on stage, and you know how when you're listening and then all of a sudden, like it could be a cartoon, because I think if they would have had a camera on me, I would have been probably, you know, doing something else during the talk. And then I was like, oh, wait. And then, you know, my eyes got bigger and bigger, and I'm like, I like this guy. And he was talking about when he ran his window cleaning company, and he was talking about their core values and basically some of the systems he had around his employees. And he was talking about his career ladder, which I don't know if you know, I just started a membership, and next month we're talking about a career ladder. But one of the things that I know and I've read recently is that when you're talking blue collar workers, honestly, that's like one of the very top benefits is having, just imagine. So if you're, you know, like if you didn't go to college, maybe you didn't even finish high school, and you come into a new company, normally you're going to feel a little stuck and almost oppressed, you know, like I got this job, it's going nowhere, you know, and feeling bad about yourself. But then if you step in a job where you come in, and I'm sure you had this, I have on the wall a career ladder, and it tells you exactly what you have to do to move to each step. And now there are possibilities. Now I can grow. I see, you know, I can see some value in myself, which is sad, but it's not always there for our employees. And you talked about your program. I'd love for you to talk about it a little bit, but it is one of those things that you inherently knew you had to do it. And that's when I was like rushing the stage after you were done. Going, okay, I got this conference in San Diego in like a month.
And, I do remember that.
Yeah. So and that I'm like, we don't even know each other, but you have got to come and speak at the conference.
That was AGSX, right?
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah.
I love it.
Well, as you were saying that, you reminded me of the problem. I mean, I had a real problem in my company. My company was a labor company. And I didn't think that. It was just that when I hired people, they just were laborers and that was all they could ever be. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't understand why I was having turnover issues and employee problems. So, I mean, they cared so little about their jobs. I realized there's no carrot in front of them. In fact, as you're saying that, I had this like analogy come to my mind. Like, can you imagine walking into a party and you're like, cool, I drove myself to the party. I'm here to have some fun. And everybody's talking in circles and you walk up to like get into a conversation and they like kind of look at you and just kind of like edge you out, like the circle tightens a little bit. That's got to be what it feels like to come into a company where it's like, there's nowhere to go. There's no way to progress. I don't even know where's the food? I want to sit in food. I'm going to like mingle with people, but there's no way to like mingle because there's no like, wait, it's completely different than someone answering the door and be like, Martha, you're here at the party.
These are
the extroverts. All the introverts are hanging out on the couch over here. We got movies playing. If you just want to sit and just chill, the food's all over here. You got to try this thing. It's delicious. You know, like just that difference right there doesn't cost you anything. But the experience is a night and day difference when you show up to the party. And I feel like that's what businesses are like, is that, you know, hey, do you know how to fog a mirror? Okay, cool. You're alive. You're breathing. Cool. We'll hire you. And then you show up and then there's no training program. There's no way for me to feel like, how do I know if I'm good at what I'm doing? How do I, you know, who's going to help me mentor me through this? And that was the problem I had to solve with my certification program, was that I realized that when I brought people in, the best they could hope to happen was that they would figure out how to be a really good window cleaner and pressure washer. And then at some point, like they're going to ask me for a raise and I wouldn't know for sure how to know if they got a raise. And it was a whole disaster. It really was a train wreck. I just didn't even know it. So my certification program was designed around basically when you came to the interview, I opened up the certification program. And the first thing I said is, if you're here just to be a laborer, you're going to hate this job. But I can promise you this, is that if you work for this window cleaning and pressure washing business, you may not always work here, but you will always look back at it as the most growing time in your life. And that includes if you go to college. Mm-hmm. And I would say that in the interview, and I would see some people be like, dude, what is this guy smoking? I'm here to just wash windows. And I knew what I needed to know then, right? And then there was other people who were like, whoa, I didn't think I was allowed to have this kind of experience in my life. I thought I was resonating since I was a high school dropout. I thought that I would just be whatever. But my certification program was designed to basically take you from level one to level five. And at level one, you pass a drug test and you have a nice personality. Mm-hmm. At level two, you're a proficient window cleaner, and you probably clean windows about as good as someone who's cleaned windows for about 5 years. And that's pretty good, but we were intentional. So we knew that we could train you up in that like within 2 months. I mean, there's not, you're getting glass wet and drying it off. I mean, it's not science, rocket science. And then level three means you know how to run a job and that you've got amazing customer service skills and you've read 3 different books, written reports on them and taken tests. And then level four means that you've basically started to run and lead. And level five shows that you're a complete mentor. At each level, you get a raise. Your raise is dependent on your success and the success of people you've trained. And it shows that you know how to, you know, as you go through, safety is the first level. And all the way from running a safe job site to one that people are raving about and writing reviews about you online, and you know, there's all sorts of stuff. But when I'm showing them in the interview that they're going to be reading the book, How to Win Friends and Influence People, taking a test and writing a report on it, and that they're going to read Delivering Happiness and Seven Habits of Highly Effective People and all of these different books, some people would respond with like, wait, I think I'm in the wrong spot. I'm here as a window washer. And when you're showing them that paper and they're having that experience, that's like, are you ready to flip your paradigm, or is that really what you want? Is that the legacy that you want to build? And that would root out certain numbers of people. But let me tell you, my company went from having cancer and like, it was just a sucky place to go to being like the most fun. Like, I just loved it. Everybody's learning and growing. Everybody has one earbud in their ear when they're outside of the house. They're talking in the trucks about different things about the business. They have to come up with experiences in their report about how they learned something from How to Win Friends and Influence People and how they used it out in the field with a customer or another employee or whatever. And like, basically they started taking things and like being in real life. And as a former college student, I graduated as the outstanding graduating student in my class at ASU's business school. And you know what? That was all theoretical. That was the hardest part about business. As I got out, started running my business, and I thought that because I was getting such good grades and my teachers were writing reports about how great of a student I was, I thought, I'm going to come out and this is going to be easy. First thing my accountant says, what kind of business entity do you want to be? What? I don't even know what you're talking about. I literally graduated from business school, did not know the difference between LLC, S Corp, C Corp, sole proprietor. I didn't know any of that garbage. And I'm like, the first question out of the gate, I didn't even know the answer to. And as you know, I've been, you know, as Josh Latimer says, jumping off a cliff and building an airplane on the way down the whole time. I thought I had the blueprints. I thought I had everything I needed. And what I found was, as soon as you get your team on board and you realize that you're the cheerleader coach, that's all you are. You are the cheerleader coach, that you're hard on your people when they need to be yelled at, not even yelled at. They need to be corrected and helped and shown what the path is, and you celebrate the living daylights out of people who are killing it. Once you put yourself into that role, the whole thing changes. Whole thing.
Yeah. Marlo says she loves you.
Love it.
Marlo says
so
I love
good.
Her. Yeah.
I'm taking notes. I'm literally taking notes.
Jeff's gonna have to watch this later because Curt doesn't talk about the five star very often.
No, he doesn't.
Yeah, that's good.
I always pin him down about that. And it's not, you know, it's not about the specifics of your program. It's about the intention behind it. And
that is it.
Because we've talked about, everybody wants to like, you know, copy a program. And
Curt, can you give me your program so I can copy it? I'm like, that's kind of like saying, Curt, can you send me the menu for the week that you're going to eat? I'm going to make all the food that you're eating. Like, have your own tastes, people.
Yeah.
But the thing is that if you're not intentional, you'll always have chaos. And that's what Martha was just saying, is that what do you want? It all starts with you grabbing a notepad. I don't have one with me right now, but you grab your notepad. Oh, you can't even see it in this thing. But you start just writing a list of all the things that you hate that are happening, because normally that's really easy to do. What are all the things that are happening in your business that you can't stand? And then from there, and it might take you a while. Like that, my list was like 12 long. When I started my certification program, I started with a legal pad of 12 pages of stuff that I just could not stand anymore. And from there, you start building, okay, then what do I want? And that changes everything.
Absolutely. Because I work with a lot of people on their culture, some never get it, but the people who get it, like Jeff, and I've got some people in lawn care.
Hobie and Jeff are in the same boat.
That come, and at the beginning, they're like, it's their damn job. They should do their job, you know? And
they should be reading my mind. They should know what I want. What's wrong with these people?
What do I pay them for? Yeah.
They're the one.
I pay my people good and I can't keep anyone because there's no good work out there. I pay tons of money and it's like, bro.
And nobody wants to work and they're all just terrible.
Nobody wants work.
Like, I am diagnosing you right now. You don't know what you even want. And if you do, you've never made it clear to anybody else.
Yep. Yep. So, but yeah, the people who it clicks with, it's so fun to watch. And hey, it had to click with me. I mean, I was like you, I had an MBA. I thought, oh, I mean, I can run a maid service. And, you know, I had supervised people and I thought I can run a maid service. And I swear I cried the first 3 years. You know, I was just like, this is horrible.
Because your MBA taught you how to be a good corporate America cubicle filler, you know?
Right.
Mm-hmm. And when you started your business and you realized that you needed to be, well, I mean, like I said, the real turn that people make and that I had to make, I just want to make sure everyone understands, I am passionate and excited about this because I did beat my head against the wall and had the blood and scars to prove it. And I turned the corner and realized if you become the cheerleader coach, if you realize that's your role, like you'll love your job again. Your employees will love working for you again. You'll understand what you want. You'll be able to turn your business into the vehicle that's driving you to where you're trying to go. And and anything less than that will just be this disaster if you keep, you know, the definition of insanity, just keep doing the same thing every day and not getting any closer to where you're trying to go. And frankly, you'll just be out in the desert because you don't even know where you're trying to go. So I do agree that the education it's nice. Like, I'm not telling anyone not to go to college. I'm just saying don't go to college and expect it to make you into an entrepreneur.
Right, right. Yeah. So, all right. We could talk about
love
this.
It. Man.
Hey, so Tay, I took your turn and we talked about sales. So you can have your turn now and talk about marketing or on the table as an option is talking about level up, but totally your choice.
Level up. That would be awesome. Ooh, that would be good.
That would be a fun one. What do you think, Curt?
Well, I do level up. I love it.
I love level up. I do love level. I could talk about level up forever. As you guys have noticed, I think that if we were like to break down this episode of how much talking I've done, I think like 92% of the talking has been me, and I apologize for that.
Hey, that's why you're here. We're using you, Curt. We've been saving up. I mean, we all really wanted you on the show, and they were like, wait, we haven't had Curt yet? No. So we're glad you're here. And I'm glad that we're going to take up the whole hour because it's absolutely worth it. Okay, Tay, I'm gonna leave it to you then to choose what you want to talk about. You might have had something else prepared, so no pressure.
No, but I think we should because it literally changed my life. I mean, I don't know how else to say it besides that Level Up program is the one thing that right now in our business, I'm able to now say like we're building a second truck. You know, we have two employees. Damien's almost out of working in the field. Like there are so many things that have happened in these last 3 months of being in this program that I would be overjoyed to talk about it. So that way other people can have the same experience that I have and be able to step into that role of being a business owner and running a business versus working in your business. Because we were talking about it last night. Like we can't believe that we were able to just get to this point. Like this is what we've dreamed about. It's what we've thought about forever. And now we're here and it's all because of the Level Up program. 100%.
That is so cool. That is so
start crying. I'm going to start crying.
Okay,
wait, you have to back up and tell everybody what a Level Up is. Cause I think people
break it down. Yeah.
Break it down.
Well, if I could, I'd like to just start off by saying that I was talking about our company values. For the longest time, for anyone who's never started a software company, there's something you need to know. It's kind of like taking a wheelbarrow full of cash and setting it on fire. You basically are just burning cash so fast you have none ever. And to make it worse is you're hiring what I call doctors in pajamas, which means that every developer you hire, they make as much money as a doctor, but they're still living in their mom's basement. And they just have ADD and they have no work ethic, but they know things that no one else knows. So they get to like have the pay. So I burned so much cash that one of my values was always giving back.
I always want to be the person who gives back. In fact, if you listen to any book from any financial guru, I don't care if it's Dave Ramsey or Susie Orman or any of the people, like not Grant Cardone. Anyway, the other really popular guy that has big multi-day event things that everyone loves, and I can't remember his name right now.
Tony Robbins.
Thank you. Because
Can I remind you that Chris Rinfo's watching right now? Just going to say that you're going to have some explaining to do for the doctor in pajamas comment and the living in the mom's basement comment. And I'm totally backing you up in the chat, but I'm not really backing up in the chat because I love Chris Rinfo.
I'll be turning the Chris Rinfo corner in a minute. But
okay,
the point is,
all right.
For the longest time, giving back for me meant that I had no money to give back. The only thing I could do was just be nice to people and help them, because as I'm building ResponsiBid, I could burn through cash faster than I could bring it in by a long shot. I mean, I sold my cleaning company and my wife never saw a single dollar of that company. I pillaged the company like a piggy bank. And then when I sold it, it was like I won the lottery, and then I lost all that. But I mean, I have a lot to show for it now, but the point is that giving back was something that I always wanted to do. And our business, as you know, has grown quite a bit. ResponsiBid has gained quite a bit of popularity, and people are starting to understand sales systems and blah, blah, blah. So we became cash flow positive a few years back, and giving back started meaning different things. Part of the reason we turned the corner is because of Chris. I was able to solve my development problem by finding a great connection with someone who I consider to be a brother, who has a great work ethic, who does work his butt off, and he does it for the right reasons for our customers. And all these things all came together, and we were able to, you know, really lift up. So giving back to me was great. I could go out and, you know, give money to companies. Well, that's dumb. Like, that's, you know, giving cash doesn't fix any problems. It's, you know, give a man a fish sort of situation. So we spent some more time thinking about it, and Level Up sort of was born from the concept of saying there's a lot of small businesses out there that are failing. And the reason that they're failing is because they don't know what they don't know. So instead of spending money on just giving it to people, why don't I help to educate people on what they don't know so that they can rise above and actually learn how to fish, so to speak, right? So I thought about it more, and I realized that we as business owners, we will always be able to influence the things that we can influence, but we have one extra lever that most humans don't get. And that is that as we, you know, in a cleaning business, you're entering people's homes. As a software company, I'm entering people's businesses. And so my network is much larger, and I have another lever. And so I said, if we're going to already donate $10,000 a year into educating businesses, let's match funds from other business owners who agree with this whole crusade. So as we started to develop this, I talked to the Conquer program. They obviously, that's sort of their boat, is teaching and coaching and accountability and all that. And so we talked to Brandon Vaughn, and we decided this is what we're gonna do. We're gonna put together a program that will allow business owners, sometimes they've been in business 20 years, but they've plateaued for the last 19. And so there's a lot of people who just don't understand what, you know, what their goals are and how to get there and what they're missing. So Brandon and I designed sort of the curriculum of it. And then we announced last year to ResponsiCon attendees that we are going to start a program that will help take people out of the pits of despair and the really yucky times of owning a business. And we're going to help elevate them through knowledge and accountability to be able to grow, and we're going to give them a hand up, not a hand out. And as we ResponsiBid fund it, we'll match any donation. And we didn't want to make it expensive, so we just said $10 a month. If you'll do $10 a month, we'll turn that 10 into 20. And now we're able to double our resources through donations of business owners who want to help. And Taylor and her husband both went through the program. They learned it. And at the end, there's a lot of other great businesses that have donated to the graduation gifts. And the graduation gifts are basically a way to say, not only did you learn, but when you were held accountable, you had done all the things you said you were going to do. And so at the end, we're going to give you all these really great things and basically give you the diving board to do your most beautiful swan dive into the deep end of the pool as you exit the program. And so it's been super fulfilling for me, but for Taylor to be able to talk about it, and we did our exit interview just a couple weeks back, to be able to hear the impact that that's having in people's lives. It's not just giving back. That's the cool thing, is we're actually building, we're you know, again, another Josh Latimerism, second time. We're changing family trees, right? So I am really-
And you're shortcutting, right? Like Tay, yeah. That was her like 3 or 5 year plan. And then in 3 months, like she got to work through a ton of that. So Saving her time and helping her and other businesses learn from mistakes and having it be a sense of community, it's really cool. It's really, really cool.
Absolutely. Yeah. So I'm super proud of you, Taylor. And the thing that people need to understand is that part of getting a hand up versus a hand out is that Taylor didn't just absorb the knowledge, and Damien didn't either. They had to learn it, do it, and basically prove that they're implementing it. And they did it. And the scariest thing for an entrepreneur is walking into the dark like that and just, you know, you're hearing the voices and people are telling you to do it. But there's a lot of times when you're like, do I want to trust these people? Like, I don't understand how this works.
Like that time that Tay came to California and we all made her sign up for ResponsiBid in 5 minutes. And then she had it set up by the end of the week. Like that time, Tay. Yeah. Poor Damien. Yeah. Poor Damien.
That was my first one. And then I remember our coach was like, you know, you're going to start doing in-person estimates. I'm like, I just got so comfortable with ResponsiBid. And now you're going to put me in front of people and I have to talk to them in person. And I was like, oh my God, I don't even know how to like come about doing this. And then we doubled our business that next month because we went in and said, we're just going to do it. There's no choice. Like you just have to take those steps and just, like you said, go into the darkness and fingers crossed, man.
Yeah.
Love it. Love it.
Love it so much. We did not talk about ResponsiCon, and I think that is a graduation gift. And we have Libby saying that she's really excited to be going. So do you want to just mention real quick the greatest sales software for the service industry, aka the only sales?
Yeah. Well, let's first say, anyone who's listening, if you want to donate $10 a month to the Level Up Scholarship and become at that point, once you're a donor to the program, you can actually nominate people into the scholarship. And we're actually looking for nominations right now. So please do. Just go to Synthesize.com, and hopefully someone can type this into the comments, but Synthesize.com/level up. That's how you can learn about the program and also click to become a $10 a month donor. We are not looking for people. We have a very special guy who takes 10% of his profit every month and donates it to the Level Up program. That is not normal, but he is passionate about this. And I should also mention he's a Canadian. And as a Canadian, I don't know why, but that just feels like half of his year is like frozen ice and he's still doing that. It's just crazy to me. But, good man. I don't think he'd be embarrassed if I told you guys. Eric Kelly is the one that does that. But we're really not looking for that. We're not trying to make an appreciable difference in your cash flow. We're just trying to give you an avenue to do something that's giving a hand up. So Synthesize.com/level up. And then ResponsiCon.com. We'll just forward you to the page Synthesize.com/ResponsiBid. But ResponsiCon.com, that is the sales conference for the service industry. Here's the thing. We started the program by talking about the difference between a snake oil salesman and a doctor approach to selling. And the huge difference, and a lot of us get scarred by the snake oil salesman, and we never want to be like that. So this conference is designed for you to network with other people, to hack with them, and to actually go to what we would consider more of like a workshop conference, where you're going and you're learning from a stage, but you're not just being inspired, pumped up, sent home to the backlog of work that you have when you get back. We've got video recording rooms set up. We've got a teleprompter there so you can actually record videos to put on your website, integrate in your sales process, help you with your follow-up process, emails, text messages, postcards, all sorts of different stuff happening there. And what we what we would hope is that when everybody gets on the airplane to go home after 3 days, not only are they inspired, but they accomplish like 3 or 4 big things that are all going to make a massive difference to their bottom line. And they don't have to go home and do it. It's already done. And they were able to run it past 5, 10, 20 other users. Well, it doesn't have to be ResponsiBid users because it's not just a ResponsiBid conference. It's anyone in the service industry. You'll talk to other attendees and beat it up. It's actually already been beaten up and used. And of course, when you get home, you might not have the same success that someone on the other coast had, but you will have a starting point. And that starting point will be far better than just your own brain. You know how 1 + 1 = 3 sometimes when you're working with other people. So someone saying, you know, I tried that, but I ran into this problem. And you go, oh, okay, well, I'll use this person's experience to modify my idea. So anyway, it's an awesome conference designed 100% for you to improve your sales process and to become less and less like a snake oil salesman, more and more like the DNA of you and something that you can replicate over and over again.
Love it. I feel like you just said a lot of amazing words that people are going to probably take some time to digest. But we will all be there. All 5 of us will be at ResponsiCon this year. So that's a dream team, I think, along with, 120 of our closest friends who will be 6 feet apart. And that's awesome. And Jeff was terrified of video, and Curt, it took him 2 years, but Curt got him in a professional videographer. He got him in front. He helped him with a copywriter, write his sales scripts, write his video scripts. He's got several of them built in. And I have all sorts of math equations about how the conference pays for itself, but you do double your conversions when you have video. So it's really just like investing in more sales, as long as you are willing to go and try and be.
You as a business owner, the more you can get yourself, like most humans will live their life doing whatever they touch will basically be changed. But as a business owner, you get like a big megaphone. Whatever goes through your employees, any of your customers that deal with you, you have this massive ripple effect because of your entitlement as a business owner. And whether you like it or not, it's gonna happen. So that's what we say is be intentional about it. And Megan did bring up a really important point. This is normally like a very huggy conference. I'm a hugger. This is normally very interactive. We would normally be breathing and spitting all over each other, like as we're yelling at each other across the table. But this year, we
You're
have
not helping. You're not helping. Keep going.
This year, we're going to change. We just need all the attendees to know this is going to be a different year. And it's not going to be the right year for some people. We've already gone down from 300 seats. The hotel's taken us all the way down to 200, now down to 100 plus vendors. It's going to be different this year. We're gonna try and keep it as much the same as we can, but our numbers are gonna be very small, which in some ways will be nice because it'll be more intimate. But this is a nonprofit event. I'm not putting it on to make cash anyway. So we're already just kind of stretching the cash to make sure that we make the event as good as it can be. You're gonna fly to Phoenix, Arizona, and then you're going to basically put on a mask. You'll take that mask off when you go into your room or when you're eating. And that is the conference. Like, you are going to do that. You're going to get your temperature checked when you walk into the room. There's going to be someone there checking your temperature. And I know it's annoying. I know that there's going to be people go, I'm not going to an event like that. And I don't blame you. If you don't want to come because of that, I totally get it. But out of consideration for the fact that, number one, this is how events in 2021 at this particular hotel, that's the only way an event's going to happen. Number two, there are people there that I love and care about who care for their parents, who have children with autoimmune disorders, who, whatever. Like, whatever the case may be, whatever your feelings are on whether masks work or not, we've been told by the powers that be, people who know a lot more about biology than me or anybody on Facebook knows, that have said wearing a mask helps. So we're gonna do it. And we're gonna do it the best we can, because we're overachievers at ResponsiCon. And so when we know that something works, we're not just gonna do nothing, we're gonna do it. And so when people come, if you feel uncomfortable with any of that and you say, I'm gonna wait till 2022 to go to your conference where we can start spitting on each other again, then that's cool.
and you can go to the spinning table. But the point is that I'm like really excited for the event, booth. But we had a modified.
We need like a Curt hugging booth for 2022.
Yeah,
and you could like booth. Donations to level up, you know, like hugs from Curt Kempton. Yeah, there you go. I love it. Yeah. Okay, well, we've officially run really long. Do we want to do a round of homework real quick?
We can, sure. Okay. Go ahead. Tay, you want to do some homework? Maybe you could post the level up information. Maybe that would be cool. People could check it out.
Yeah, because I don't know. I couldn't get on to see what y'all talk about. So okay. I'm going to post the level up link in the group, and I encourage you guys to all check it out and make sure you can sign up for that $10 donation if you can.
And if your company is in the red right now, don't feel like you need to donate. Your company's in the black though, please consider donating towards people that you're trying to raise the tide for.
Love it.
I need help on sales homework. Let's do favorite sales book. You mentioned three. And we did book recommendations last week, and that was kind of fun. So favorite sales book. You know what?
Delivering Happiness by Tony Hsieh. And his name is spelled T-S-I-E-H, I think. He's the founder of Zappos. Delivering Happiness. Yeah. I would recommend everybody read that book and anybody who does sales for your team reading that book.
Good one.
Perfect.
Love it.
It's about culture too. So
yes, well, it is about culture, but it's about, you know, selling for all the right reasons, and the culture, of course, is deeply, deeply tied into that.
Yep.
And I am going to do a systems homework because our folks on the phones actually do disqualify people, and I'm going to ask you to list five disqualifiers in your business this week that would help your people on the phone identify if this is not a good customer for you, because putting those people in that disqualified bucket is incredibly valuable information. And if that means creating a tag in your CRM of disqualified, if that means, you know, making them somehow identifiable, it's super important. So I'm going to make you list five of the things that do not work if they're your customer of your business. So how to disqualify peeps.
I like it.
Okay. And I was sitting here thinking, oh man, I don't want to have the career ladder as homework again. So I thought of something different. I want you, Curt touched on this. And this is actually the very first session of what I teach in Level Up, is that you identify what you want, to happen. And to identify what you want to happen in your company, you first have to say what you hate is happening in your company right now. So Curt had 12 pages. I'll follow Michelle and say, list five things that are happening in your company and you hate those things. And then you need to pick the top one or two and figure out what you're going to do about it. So that's my homework.
If they list five, they're going to have 500. I just guarantee. Because listing what you hate is so much easier than listing what you want.
Yep.
Love it.
And if this
Love
is it. Your first time joining Fight Club, the way the homework works is we have a private Facebook group where you can join and we will help hold you accountable. We post our homework each week based on the area of expertise that we just offered, and we will help hold you accountable. The theory is if you could do one of our homework assignments, you don't have to do all four or five, sometimes you have five. If you could do one every week, you will be moving the needle on your business. You will be improving your systems, your culture, your finances, and your marketing strategy every single week and getting better, because that is the goal of Fight Club for Business, is to help you fight for your business. So Michelle, do we have a quote of the week maybe?
We do have a quote. Of course we do. And it is from Siva Devaki. That's an interesting name, Siva Devaki. And they say that sales is not about selling anymore, but about building trust and educating. And ResponsiBid is all about that. So enjoy your week, everybody. Thank you guys for joining us in the Fight Club. Have an awesome week and keep fighting.
Bye. Next Tuesday. Thanks, Curt. Yay. We love you.
Thanks, Curt.
Love you, ladies, so much.
Okay, bye.
Connect with Fight Club for Business. Join our Facebook group where we have weekly homework, accountabilities, and an awesome community to help you fight for your business.
facebook.com/fightclub4, as in the number 4, business. Fight Club for Business.